Sign number one that you are going through this homecoming phase of awakening is that you might find yourself making mountains out of molehills. Little things that really on paper aren't the biggest deal in the world, you are acting and thinking about them as if they are. An example that comes to mind, I was thinking about this a minute ago as I was about to film this video. I was helping my friend Aaron Dowdy run a live event, if, I don't know, 6 months ago or so, last June, in Sedona. And we were, you know, me and Aaron and the crew were kind of walking in, and a lot of the guests, we were just finishing up something, and they were leaving the arena or whatever. And as I was walking by, this one person kind of gave me this look, this female gave me this kind of look. And she probably meant nothing by the look, but I read into this look, this sort of like glance at me, I perceived it, that she was thinking in her mind that this guy is ugly and I hope he gets away from me. I had no proof that was on her mind. There's probably, who knows? But anyway, it was like that little molehill in my mind was a huge thing. And then I went through life, God, am I unattractive? It started to get me thinking back to like junior high and high school. And I remember I had acne at one point, and I had all this, like, not trauma, but these like really big experiences of feeling very uncomfortable in my own skin, basically. And this one little look, this one little molehill became a mountain. Sign number two, emotionally triggered. It wasn't just that this circumstance triggered a bunch of thoughts, even though they did. A lot of like irrational concerns, I must say with honesty. But it was more so the emotional trigger. It felt like a dagger to my chest emotionally. It hurt my feelings. Nothing happened, obviously, but that's kind of how it felt. I felt the same exact feelings I felt back in high school and junior high. That same shame, that same like where I didn't like who I was. I didn't like how I looked. I didn't like the reflection in the mirror. I wished I was different. That internal conflict of resisting what is, who I am, what I look like. I was feeling it emotionally. If anything, more intensely than back in junior high and high school. So you might find that not only are you overreacting like in your head and based on your perception of this little disturbance in your life, but also emotionally it feels over the top. And the funny thing is when we react emotionally like that, when we're triggered, the mind is so good at rationalizing it. So we almost can sometimes get into our mind and make stories like, you know what, this person for sure had it out for me. How dare her, blah, 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 blah. You know, and we can start to get lost in this complete fabricated reality based upon our wounded past projecting itself into this very minimal circumstance. It's not funny, it's kind of comical when you put it like that, but at the time it's not. At the time it feels very like serious, like very, this is a very dire circumstance that I must address at once. Number three, and finally the silver lining in all this, is there's awareness. You're not doing this unconsciously. You're fully aware that you're overreacting. You're fully aware that there's some wound inside of you being pinged by this little circumstance, and that's completely distorting your perception of what's happening. You are watching yourself. You're conscious of these irrational reactions that probably in the past have been completely unconscious. You may have gone to great lengths throughout your entire life to avoid those exact feelings, these exact types of instances that now you find yourself stuck in. And there's the hope in that awareness. Just being able to observe that what is happening is reactive, it's conditioning. Just if that's happening, what does that imply? That implies there's this other awareness, this other you, this expanded version of you, suddenly not so connected to this response, but rather can observe it from the outside. And then once you can observe yourself acting like a weirdo or whatever, then you can start to speculate why. Why am I reacting this way? This person just walked by me. Who am I? How do I know she thought that? And if she did, who cares? I don't even know this person. Why would I let it ruin my afternoon? You start to question these things. And these questions, they start to lead to answers. They start to take you back in time. They start to take you back into sometimes repressed memories from childhood, early childhood, adolescence, where these feelings were felt at one time, but not dealt with properly, not accepted, basically. And therefore, collected and stored in our body. And then we're walking around like this, so anytime something happens, it's like, it comes up because we held on to them. But the fact, the cool thing is, you're aware of all of this. And you know there's this, you might sense even, there's this opportunity to break through. There's this opportunity to break the cycle and to let this energy go, to heal it. You might become aware through this mountain being turned into a molehill and this over-the-top emotional reaction that there's something unresolved in me. Now, that oftentimes can lead to a strong desire to heal it, to remove it. Has that happened to you? Where you've become aware of some of your own unconsciousness and aware how it's bleeding into your life and distorting your perception of yourself and reality and negatively impacting maybe some very key areas of your life. And then really felt motivated finally to get rid of it, heal it. I need to drink ayahuasca. I need to get some relief. I need to find a way to fix this. And maybe you've been there for a while, trying to fix yourself, trying to heal yourself. It makes sense. It's understandable. Who wants to continue to deal with the repercussions of acting out unconsciously? Nobody does. But you might have also found this approach, this desperation to fix yourself and heal the wounds, it doesn't usually quite work. Only in the temporary. Sometimes you get these temporary insights or whatever, but it always comes back. And you must just think, there must just be more. There's just more of my shadow I gotta go in and sort of, you know, heal. And during this time, you might find yourself also being assisted. There's divine assistance when we are in this process of healing and transformation. So I just ran this retreat in Costa Rica where about 35 guests came and drank ayahuasca. I didn't run it, I'm not a shaman, but I organized it with my friend Aaron. And anyway, these people were going through this exact same sort of homecoming process, and they felt this resonance to this opportunity to drink ayahuasca. Maybe for you it's like, no, I'm messing with that. I don't like to put stuff in my body like that. But maybe for you it's something else. Maybe you find this, a new documentary comes on Netflix and it just sort of, it's like telling you exactly what you need to hear. Maybe a YouTube video, maybe a book, maybe a friend. Sometimes when these energies are very much up at the surface, they're up at the surface. And it's sort of like, even though they're kind of invisible, they're affecting things. They're affecting people, they're affecting you. You might play them out in kind of a way where you're learning these lessons and getting these reflections. Or somebody else might just pick up on it and say something that, it's almost like when they come up like this, it's at a peak of discomfort and there's this desire to heal it. But at this sort of, in this place is also where like healing and magic and divine assistance come in a myriad of different forms. I'm sure you've experienced it. Synchronicity, dreams, again, hearing the right message at the right time, being naturally attracted to a modality that will help you. We'll just come into your life. You don't have to do anything I'm saying. You'll have your own version of the things I'm saying, and they'll be just as aligned for you. Bashar calls them permission slips. Meaning, like, we all have our different belief systems and we're going to believe certain things will work, and then they will likely work for us, even though they might not work for other people because they have different beliefs. You're going to have your own version of attracting exactly what you need to finally resolve this. And number 5, you may find, Maybe you haven't, and this is going to help you if that's the case. You might find that the key is not to heal. The key is not to release as much as you would like to. The key, I'm finding, is to accept, to embrace. An example that comes to mind that inspired this video, recently on this trip to Costa Rica, after this ayahuasca retreat was over pretty much, and it was just me and my friends and the crew kind of hanging out, I was confessing to them that I had a lot of these insecurities coming up from within my marriage. We've been married almost 15 years, my wife and I, but I have this part of me that gets insecure sometimes, and for very irrational reasons. And this was coming up exactly as I kind of shared with you. This exact phenomena was happening to me in Costa Rica. My wife was doing a lot more with the retreat. She was taking more ownership and just kind of being away more, and it was new. Normally we were kind of hanging out a lot of the time. And my reaction was, maybe she's falling out of love with me. Maybe she's gonna fall in love with some Shaman Dave or something, some new medicine guy, because I'm not really into that as much as she is. And anyway, I was aware, luckily, that this was completely unconscious, completely rooted in the past, and I wanted to heal it. I went into the ayahuasca ceremonies wanting to fix it. I got nothing. And I felt so trapped in my conditioning. And finally, as I was talking about it with my friend Matt and Aaron, I was like, Matt could pick up on my tone and the way I was speaking about my conditioning. I was speaking about it with anger. I was thinking like, man, why don't you get your shit together? I'm so sick of feeling this way. It had that kind of vibe to it. And Matt luckily picked up on it. And he noticed that I was speaking to like a part of myself with almost hostility. And in the moment, I was like, no, you don't understand. You don't understand. But then I sat with it for a minute and I realized that that's exactly what I was doing. And the floodgates of awareness opened and I realized there's a part of me. Hence this whole video, the homecoming process, there's a part of me, another version of Victor that this identity is ashamed of, embarrassed of. And that version of me is the one who was cheated on in high school. I was cheated on. And that made me feel rejected, unworthy. So this situation, as I talked about, that was just sort of bringing awareness to that part of me that has been suppressed ever since. This part of me saying, hey, I'm still here. Hey, I'm suffering. Hey, I'm trapped in time. I'm trapped in a loop. You won't even look at me. You won't even acknowledge me. You just want to heal me. You just want to fix me. You just want to release me. And all I want to do is be acknowledged and brought with you, homecoming. And once I just realized all that, realized that I was resisting a part of myself, a wounded part of myself that needs me, it needs my support, my love, not to be pushed away or attempted to be expelled with ayahuasca or breathwork. It's like, no, you need to take me under your arm and say, let's roll through life together. I know you were cheated on, I know it sucks, but I got you. And once I did that, I literally felt a weight lifted. I could actually feel this other part of me just like being reabsorbed into my being. And I felt more whole. It's a process of homecoming, a process of calling back these fragmented parts of yourself. These parts of yourself that you don't want to admit are there, that maybe you're ashamed of. They're trying to come home, they're trying to come back. And the way it starts is with these making molehills into mountains. Awareness of your over-the-top reaction. Initially, the desire to heal and to fix. Eventually yielding and saying, you know what? Fixed or not, healed or not, come on in, I got you. Your inner child just wants to be included. Just wants to become a valid part of you, because it is. And then even though these triggers might flare up, there can be echoes of them, it won't even matter. Because there's this new awareness that, oh yeah, I got you. In fact, that happened. It was so funny how after that happened, there were little instances where little Vic or whatever was still pinged. But because I had this whole thing going on in my head at one point, I was able to deal with it very differently. And instead of getting like frustrated or resistant, I was able to literally in my own head say, I got you. It's okay. We're going to be fine. And then this sort of togetherness completely took the edge off those triggers. So what lost parts of your perhaps inner child have you been ignoring, trying to keep at bay, or trying to just sort of like bring in to heal real quick? Try it. Try this homecoming technique, which is not really a technique. It's more of like just an acceptance of these other parts of yourself. And an understanding that though they don't define you, like fully, they are part of you. And it's okay to own that. And there's peace. There's a feeling of homecoming, a feeling of completion when you own that. I'll leave you with this example that my wife is always sharing. It's of the rose. My wife is obsessed with rose. She has done rose dietas where she's literally restricted her food and her calories and almost like welcomed in the consciousness, the spirit of the rose plant. And she sees that as a teacher, as a plant teacher. And she says rose has a sort of a spunky personality, Patty always says. She says rose is very much proud of her thorns. She says rose thinks they're beautiful. Rose thinks they make her unique. They make her dynamic. They're cool. And she gives no fucks about what people think of her thorns. She owns it. And who here judges the thorns of a rose? No, we find roses to be gorgeous, beautiful, beautiful specimens of life. As are you, even with your thorns.